Settle. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I'm Rebecca Eaton, executive producer of Masterpiece. And and boy, am I glad to see you, and boy, are you glad to be here. Apparently, there were 10,000 applicants for the several hundred seats that you lucky people are sitting in. And apparently, for the very few standby seats, someone was outside the Alliance Française at 7 o'clock this morning, and I hope she's in here. No, you're here! You got in! Great. So, we're just sitting here talking about whatever you'd like to talk about, but maybe you'd like to meet these people. Shall I introduce them? At the end, Sue Virtue, who is the producer of Sherlock and a principal at Hartswood Films, which makes Sherlock. And Sue is responsible for everything happening on time, on budget, and on the air. And among her other jobs is to wrangle her husband, sitting next to her, Stephen Moffat. And Stephen, you will know, is the co-creator with Mark Gatiss of Sherlock. He is the co-showrunner with Mark, who plays Moriarty. Of course,
Mycroft.
Oh, what a terrible crowd to make that mistake. plays Mycroft. And he also is the showrunner of Doctor Who on BBC. Why am I even saying all this stuff? You know this so well. And did you know that he was one of the writers on Tintin? Yes! Well, yes, he did other things. So, and sitting next to me is, what's his name? Benedict Cumberbatch, who? Just recently was awarded the Olivier Prize in London for his performance in Frankenstein at the National Theater. He, of course, is also in Star Trek. He also was in War Horse, Tinker Tailor, and seen on the screen on Masterpiece in Small Island and Last Enemy, and
To the Ends of the Earth.
Very good. Very good.
Okay.
So the two people who are not with us are sadly Mark Gatiss, the co-creator with Stephen of Sherlock. They thought it up. Yeah. And Dr. Watson, Martin Freeman. Who is in New Zealand making another movie? Okay. So I only have one thing to say, then I will shut up. And the only thing I'll say is that's enough. We have to go in however long we have here. But I just want to tell you, Masterpiece will be co-producing with BBC Wales and with Hartswood Films the next series of Sherlock, which will go into production early in 2013 and will be on the air here sometime in 2013. That's official. Okay. Oh, no. Enough. So we've got to go. It's been awfully nice. So I think what we better do is open this up for questions. So please direct your questions at whoever you like. Yes, right here.
What are the better parts of playing Sherlock? So what's most difficult and what's easier about Sherlock?
The deductions are very hard to do. The birth of them is quite painful, but they're fun to watch, and everyone's very patient with me getting through the trauma of doing it. But look, it's a gift of a role. It's a real pleasure, and it's very humbling to bring it to a crowd like you lot as well today. It's extraordinary, and you know, I have no complaints or difficulties with it. It's the kind of challenge every actor should relish. And I genuinely can say that it's really good fun to do. The hours are long, it's tough, and all the rest of it. But you know, I'm still getting paid to do what I love.
And we're doing it.
Well, thank you for watching it and coming here today. You know, it's a joy. It's an absolute joy.
This is a question for Stephen. I think you write some of the best TV, so I'm always surprised to see critiques of your female characters on the internet.
Gotcha.
Yeah, hi. So I was wondering if you could respond maybe to, without spoilers, I think some people may haven't seen the season two, sorry.
I really don't think that's true.
Is that okay if I ask it? Okay. Could you respond to the...
Who hasn't seen it?
Yes, sir.
Really? One person.
Okay, well then...
Five
Get
people.
Out.
Could you respond to critiques that say your version of Irene Adler is weaker because she is rescued versus... Sorry, I said it.
No, wait.
Versus
no, hang on.
The original story in which, yeah, she gets away scot clean.
Irene, I love the original story. It's brilliant. But her triumph in the original story is to move house with her husband. I mean, it wasn't really going to be the climax in 90 minutes. I remember reading that story, and I loved it. I love all the Sherlock Holmes stories, but it's got a better beginning than an end. Because it starts off saying to Sherlock Holmes, she was always the woman. And as a 12-year-old, I was thinking, why? What is this going to be? I cannot imagine what torments are in store. What magnificent thing is she going to do? Running away wasn't it. It was actually at that age I thought, Sherlock, why are you so keen on her? Is there something else going on for you here? Because I'm not getting it from the plot. But I don't know what to say without spoiling our very precious ending. I think there was somebody who was attempting to extract a version of my own personal sexual politics based on a scandal in Belgravia, which is completely untrue, but let me tell you this. You can extract Mark Gatiss's views on dogs from the Hounds of Baskerville. Because what Mark likes to do with dogs is accuse them of murder and explode them.
Hello.
That was it.
Okay. Where's the mics?
I got the next one. I'm way up here.
Up here.
This is for, first of all, thank you guys so much for coming to America. This is amazing. And this could be for any of the three of you. How do you feel about the slight edits that have to be made when you put a British show on American television? You know, just cut for time or for anything like that?
We're going to show the rest of it. It's not just that.
No. I mean, just little bits, like little chips of dialogue that's not necessarily needed for the plot, but is just sort of fleshed out for story that was missing.
Maybe so.
It is difficult because you start loving all of it. And funny enough, we were just watching it and there was a little cut there and Bendit went, you cut that bit. You have to cut little bits. But I think if you don't know they're there, hopefully you don't miss them.
I hate it. I do. I genuinely want you to have the full feast. It's not fair. You're as loyal as any other fan in any other part of the world. But it's a politically dangerous thing to be sat on
Rebecca,
this stage.
We'll talk to Rebecca, see if we can get them any longer next time.
I feel two producers leaning in to tell me to
well,
stop.
Well, I'll say this. It has to do with the BBC length and the PBS length. But I will tell you this. We don't make the edits. Hartswood makes the edits. Yeah. Sue and Stephen make the choice.
Yeah. Just not approved with Benedict.
It's up to her. I can only ask one question, so Benedict, I'm going to pick you. I see a lot of Machiavelli's The Prince in Sherlock Holmes, very much the ends justifying the means. When you were considering being Sherlock, doing any type of research, did you read anything like Machiavelli or possibly forensic psychology, maybe even delving into things like an analysis of different killers or things like that? Like, did you take it into a darker place when you were looking at him as this complex kind of Asperger-y? So he's a high-functioning sociopath, yeah. That's
well,
it.
She's got her essay ready.
I did read a lot, but I mainly read the Sherlock Holmes stories. And I'm not being flippant. I know exactly what you mean. There is a level of calculation and darkness to him, but it is all there in the original. It's what Conan Doyle read. It's what Conan Doyle sourced that I was more interested in. And how that formulates into something that then obviously
is going to be playable and then, you know, translatable into the 21st century, very well fed by an enormously brilliant script, both by him, Mark, and Steve, the other Stephen. So I didn't need to research the type. The type was very clear to see for me. I don't know if that says more about me than my lack of research. But no, I might have to revisit that. I did read that at school, The Prince. We don't want to talk about your problems. No, you've travelled a long way. All is forgiven. I'm teasing you. It's a very mean thing to say. No, it's very impressive that you read that for fun.
Wait a minute. Where's the mic?
I'm right here.
She's got a voice. She doesn't need a mic.
Okay.
That was actually, if you look very carefully, it's the Dancing Men. Yeah, it is the Dancing Men. It's very, very loose. It's loosely, but it's the Dancing Men.
And it's, I mean, got it's bits not, of. What else?
I can't remember what other bits it's got, but it's the Dancing Men is you know, the codes, the that's very, very broadly. But you know, we take our story and jump off in all directions with it. We don't necessarily stick to it. You know.
Okay, we have a question down here. You have to
this
yell.
This young lady has been desperate.
Which young lady? Oh, this young lady.
Yes.
Now you have a mic.
Yes.
Okay. Hi. First off, I want to say, give a shout out to all of my UK Tumblr friends who are staying up very late to watch this right now. Second part, I guess, for all, I guess, three of you, what are your favorite, or what have been your favorite scenes in the Sherlock series? I guess you can, I mean, since most of us have seen the second series, but you don't have to spoil it. Favorite scenes, either to write, to act in, to film, etc. Thank you.
Well, I do love the scene in Buckingham Palace that you just saw. I love it. I like seeing the rear end of Sherlock, and I like... And I also like seeing the rear end of Laura Pulver, who plays Irene Adler. Yes.
And you?
Well, yeah, obviously I like the bit. Yeah, no, I'm going to stop. Golly, it's really hard to choose. It's different as well, because there are ones that are really hard to do that are really enjoyable to watch, and all of them are slightly weird to watch. I get very nervous in my own audience. I can sit back and still enjoy it, and it's wonderful to have been able to vicariously enjoy it through your enjoyment of it, like today, like at the back. And mm-hmm. We were standing behind the screen at the beginning. I don't know if you knew. But it was a cheeky way of just seeing what the reaction was going to be. And I don't know, I'm not being specific. I mean, I do really like the when she takes me back through the deduction in when I'm passed out and I'm not getting it. I kind of like to see him compromised every now and again. I know the pyrotechnics of him being completely in control of what we love and know of him as a strong hero, but it's a beautiful thing when he's being led by the hand into something unexpected. And I like that moment. There are other moments in other episodes which I do like, but I'm not going to talk about them because they haven't been aired yet.
Probably because of the reaction it got, I probably liked the swimming pool scene at the end of series one. But especially if you add the resolution to it at the beginning of series two, I think that was just huge fun. I don't have to wait a year and a half for the Bee Gees. I thought that was quite funny. I like that.
I like the bed scene, only because I know how we shot it. Mm. From a production point of view, that's great. It was an actual bed on a pivot thing, and you stood there, and it... Well, it was great, wasn't it? We had a bed in a field, as you do.
I'm just going to hold this like an old-fashioned microphone. Like Barry Manilow. It's really good. It's going to screw up the levels, isn't it? Sorry, boys who are on the microphone. I'm going to hold it reasonably equidistant. Anyway, the point is this. we did it in a field, and it was extraordinary, and there were gnats biting our heads, and we had so little time to do it, and it worked the first time, and it got a round of applause from the crew. So we rushed back to have a look at it. And it is, it's a bit of magic dreamt up by Paul McGuigan, wasn't it?
Yeah.
I mean, it really
was. We
were
in the middle of Wales with a bed.
Yeah, he's
and a wall.
Very much missing, yeah, absolutely.
Paul McGuigan is the director of this episode.
And really the inventor of a lot of the visual vernacular that's even, possibly even defined this as something new. And
I'm so tired of me talking all day. I'm so sorry. I'm not making any sense. What I'm trying to say is stuff like the text floating on screen. That was his idea. The rich tapestry of color and wallpaper and the way he places objects within the frame and the cutting, the editing. Him and Charlie dreamt up these brilliant ideas, such as in the first series, these wipes and swipes you had where one scene would just come across another rather than fading out and cutting to another scene, that two different places at the same time would bleed into the same screen. We owe him an awful lot. And Yeah, it's a shame he's not here. He would have loved the reaction you gave it.
Yeah. Now, apparently we have two mics, so if I knew where they were, I would really...
Hello.
Okay.
Hi, Ginger in the back.
Yeah.
Okay, this question is for Stephen and Benedict. Stephen, if you could have tea with any of the characters you've written for, and Benedict, if you could have tea with any of the characters you've acted as, who would you have tea with?
What a good question.
Should we go first?
No.
I've had tea with Stephen Hawking. Sorry, that's a bit smart that I have.
Irene Adler, the way she dresses.
What a mistake.
Specified tea, darling. It was just tea.
Swiftly moving on. I'd like to have tea with Sherlock. I think it'd be great. I think he'd dismiss me in a heartbeat, though. He's far too impatient and far too clever. I wouldn't last a second, but it would be fun to be in his presence. Gosh, who else?
Martin Freeman.
I don't play Martin Freeman. And I've also fortunately got a friendship that's strong enough to just about have a cup of tea with him as well. Yeah. We have many on set. Gosh, who else? I don't know, you choose. Who do you think I should have? He's not a character I've played.
Yes. Good point.
Wait.
Okay. We'll move on from that question.
Are you getting this?
What? I'm sorry, right. Oh, God, no. Oh, no. He'd spill it on himself, and then I'd have to clean it up for him, and then he'd walk into a door, and I'd have to phone an ambulance, and then he'd end up hijacking the ambulance by accident, thinking it was his taxi home that he was... I don't know. He's a disaster.
Okay. And, Stephen, are you still back with Irene Adler?
Apparently so.
I think I probably would, actually. I could probably opt for Sherlock Holmes, to be honest. Just to see
would.
How long you could last.
Yeah.
I think you could last longer than any of us.
So go and make a deduction, Sherlock, and then he'd deck you.
There you go.
And you'd leave. But, yeah.
Okay, back up here.
And be sure to wait for the microphone to ask for your questions for the people who are watching on Facebook.
Hello. Oh. Sorry.
Yeah.
I have a question for both Benedict and Stephen. Do you find it intimidating at all to kind of have your own version of Sherlock Holmes, as there's so many, I mean, Arthur Conan Doyle's version, of course, is the classic, and it's got to be intimidating for you, Stephen, to write your modern day version. And for you, Benedict, is it intimidating because there's so many actors that have and will play Sherlock in the future?
No.
No.
Okay. Next question.
Look, it would be a waste of our golden opportunity to go around feeling intimidated. No, you get to... and, you know, if we made a complete mess of it, at least there'd be loads of other versions of Sherlock lying around. There's, like, spares. So it was... No, it was. It's not. It's just the best fun. So you can do your... You can do good.
It's a treat and a privilege to be asked to play that character. So, you know, you can't be intimidated by it. You've just got to grab it by the horns and have fun.
You should have seen this before the first episode went out.
Terrified.
You were
terrified.
Exposed the lie of that in a heartbeat. Oh, we sounded so confident there. It almost sounded convincing.
Okay, who has the mic? Let's do it that way. Yes.
Hello. I'm Aubrey from Sherlock NYC. I just wanted to thank you so much, Mr. Cumberbatch, Mr. Moffat, and Ms. Virtue for coming out here. We're a group in New York City. There's a bunch of Sherlock Holmes fans. We actually recently had a screening in January for the Series 1, and we had a study in Sherlock, a study in pink and a study in scarlet. So I just wanted to thank you so much for all the hard work that you've done bringing us this show. I've been able to meet hundreds of new friends, been able to read some wonderful literature, and I'll zip it up and get to my question. My question is, if someone were to hand you a blank check and you're suddenly given a blank check. You can do whatever project you want and whatever role you'd like to have in it, producing, directing, starring, whichever we have time for. Can I ask what that project would be and why?
If it was a blank, if it was a blank check, I'd do more than one, but it would be,
it'd be
it would be nice to do a film with Sherlock Holmes, wouldn't it?
A feature.
Yeah.
But I don't know. I'd, there's a very good book called Cavalier and Clay. I'd love to do that.
Have you talked to Stephen about writing?
To this Stephen?
That's
oh, God, I never talked to him about writing. That would be intimidating. That really would be scary. No, I haven't.
And Stephen, in your blank check?
Oh, my blank check? Oh, this is a tragedy. If I were given the blank check, I would, of course, and you know the answer, be doing Sherlock Holmes and Doctor Who. Yeah. Sadly, I can confirm the check is in no way blank, but...
So, Sue, what is the... Has anybody talked about this, the television series, the American television series? What's the state of that?
Oh, thanks, Rebecca.
Just no, to clarify, as Sue was misquoted a little while ago as saying she was consulting on it, it was in broadcast in the UK.
Yes, right. The next, my next string to my bow, I think it said, wasn't it? I was now consulting on Elementary. I'm not.
No.
No, we've heard nothing more about it. I know they've made the pilot. It's nothing to do with us at all.
Nothing to do with us.
No.
And we don't necessarily wish it the best, right? Right.
No. No, no, Johnny's a friend. And, you know, as we already know with the Downey Jr. movie franchise, there's room enough for two, so why not three?
Oh, you know, what a good friend you are.
It's fine. It's fine. It'll be different. And I don't think it's going to take away the love for ours. And there's no reason to be churlish or bitter about them or, you know, what they're trying to do.
What a gent. What a gent. And the actor he refers to, Johnny Lee Miller, of course, was also in Frankenstein.
I think they know that. No, it's
you know
right
that?
To say it, but I think they know it.
Okay, and here comes the
I know more than I do.
Hello.
Right
I'm a private investigator here in New York. So I was just, I was wondering since
you
were...
You're not now.
It's a bit slow, so no, it's an advantage not to look like one, believe it or not. But I was wondering, since you were bringing Sherlock into the modern times, if you ever had to, you know, consult anybody who is, in fact, a private or consulting detective in the... Because there's tons of them in the UK. The UK is the number one country for private detectives.
Yeah, we know. We've got the media that they feed.
Yeah, I mean, really, So I was just wondering if any of you did any research or followed anybody around who is actually a private investigator.
Can you follow a private detective?
Actually, I have
Wouldn't
been hired
they be
to
a bit rubbish?
Fellow private investigators,
you have to hire an investigator to investigate an investigator.
Yeah.
All privately.
You never know.
No, it's a sensible question. I haven't, and I probably should, and I'd love to. He is exceptional and extraordinary, and sort of probably beyond the pale of any working methods you employ. So therefore, I don't know how much I'd be able to feed any kind of logical deductions about your working methods into the way we operate. I'm sure you're
we
much more legal
than
above board.
We did talk to the police in the first series a bit about procedures and things like
that.
But sometimes, actually, even if you take the proper procedures, Sherlock won't necessarily follow them. Really, William,
exactly,
you don't...
Exactly, exactly. Ooh, he says spitting everywhere. I hope Facebook got that. It's you're right. He's above the operation of the police, so it's kind of... It's fascinating to talk to them about. And you know, despite the ill rap that the police get through Sherlock's impatience with them, it's a much, much serious by the policemen I've spoken to, and women. Policewoman.
Oh, good.
Yeah,
good.
It is, yeah. We're just having a private conversation.
Hello.
You're still here.
Hi. My name's Chris Kelly. I'm from Charlottesville, Virginia. I drove up here for this event. I wanted to ask, first of all, congratulate you on your recent Olivier Award win with Johnny Lee Miller. And
thank you.
To ask you, do you have current plans to return to the theater? Is that a passion for you, or are you going to stick to TV and movies with your schedule?
I haven't left the theater. I will always do theater in my life. I like to mix it up a bit. I'm really genuinely hoping to bring Frankenstein here, and Danny, I know, has already been in talks with producers, so... that's it. Sounds like we might have an audience, so that's encouraging. I love theatre. It's where I began, and while I owe it an awful lot, I've also had incredible breaks in both the other mediums. So it's a modern world for actors where you can start almost, it seems, at any level in any medium. So the usual trajectory of classical roles into small parts in television, da 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 da. Little bit of that I've done, I still feel equally loyal to all of them, so I'll never give up on theatre.
Great, thank you so much.
Pleasure.
Hi, I guess to go with that question, I had a question for Benedict about Frankenstein, and if you wouldn't mind talking a little bit about the process or comparing the work that you did to prep for Frankenstein versus what you do for Sherlock. I know some people are very touchy about talking about their craft, but if you could say anything about it.
Oh, I'm not touchy about talking about my craft. They're very, 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 very different creatures, no pun intended, but I mean, there are crossovers, of course, because it's about a man who wants, they're both about men who have God complexes, people who think that they can cheat death or be better than the living. And there is a huge parity between Dr. Frankenstein and Sherlock, which I was very aware of, which is one of the main reasons I would only do the project were I allowed to play both sides of that coin and play the creature as well. There was a bit of the creature in that episode of the creature in Sherlock, because when he's drugged and he's getting out of the bed, I think my physicality fell a little bit into what some of what I did when I was scrambling about on the floor at the beginning of the evening in the theatre that was Frankenstein. But
you went to the gym more for Frankenstein, didn't you?
I went to the gym a bit more. Yeah, no, actually, for Frankenstein, no, not really. No, I did a bit. Oh, this is very boring. Do I need to talk about that? Yoga and swimming for Sherlock, and then I did a bit more sort of press ups and stuff for Frankenstein, and endurance. But it's just, yeah, you're laughing now.
It was the end of the last one when you were trying to fatten up a bit for Parade's End.
Yeah, I know.
Yeah, during Sherlock.
During Sherlock, yeah, going to the donuts. The preparation is very different, obviously, because you're working in very intense, concentrated bursts on Sherlock, but at the same time you're carrying a series for the duration of the shoot, so there is an idea of it being a marathon, but you're not, obviously, this is so obvious, you're not playing out the whole character arc, whereas every night with Frankenstein it was. So really it was a 10-hour day. Not that I'm complaining, that's probably what most normal people do. Although they don't get naked in front of 1,100 people and throw themselves off 6 foot drops.
Stop promoting the show, Benedict.
and so it was very paramount to kind of keep myself fit and healthy, as it is with both, just to not get ill and to be able to do it. And I've failed a couple of times at Frankenstein, so I could do better there. I promise to if we do it here. But I think, yeah, it's remarkable how theatrical you can be allowed to be on screen, especially with a gorgeous, colourful, broad character as Sherlock can be at times. And again, you can do intense focus work and sort of close-up work on stage, no matter how epic the production. So they do have a crossover, not just in types of characters, because I try to avoid that, but also in scale of performance. That answers a bit of your question. I went to a dissection, actually. I went to, not a dissection, an autopsy for Frankenstein, which I probably should have done for Sherlock, considering I was in the morgue in Sherlock before I got on stage as the doctor, but that was very interesting for both projects, really, to be at ease with a lifeless body, to marvel at the wonder of nature and not be upset by the kind of gruel of it, and it was a very humbling experience. It was extraordinary, and I recommend it.
Right here, I am standing up. Yes, right here. As a native Bostonian, I want to thank you, first of all, Rebecca, for all you've done for GBH and for Boston. But this is...
one clap, come on.
Yes. But this is actually for all of you. But first of all, for Benedict, at what point in your life were you first exposed to Sherlock Holmes's novels? And then how did that affect your character? But then for all of you... what is, in terms of like the extent to which you collaborate on how far one actor can go with his or her role, and you know the collaboration, the push and pull in terms of the whole process?
I to be honest, it was Jeremy Brett's interpretation. My mother was a friend of his, and so That was the first sort of conscious memory I have of Sherlock Holmes, and what a wonderful Sherlock Holmes he was. I mean, really masterful, and Rathbone as well. And then I probably read them when I was 12 to 14, sometime around that. Weirdly enough, I'd read The Hobbit, or had The Hobbit read to me before that, but anyway, that was probably the beginning of my interest in the literature. And then I didn't obsess over it. I wasn't a massive fanboy of it. I came to it very much through being asked to consider the idea of doing a modern Sherlock Holmes. And then I just, as I have, read them rapidly. So, yeah, I can't remember the second part of your question. Can you answer that?
At what point do all of you collaborate?
Oh, every day on set. I mean, you know, there's a brilliant... Is that what you, yeah, well, no, we have read-throughs, and obviously we had a first series which Stephen saw our strengths in, and I think both him and Mark and the other Stephen, as he keeps on getting referred to by me, wrote. We should credit the other Steve Thompson, who wrote both. Yes, quite right. The Blind Banker and The Wife of Mark Ford. I think all right to our strengths, and you saw a relationship burgeoning between, just a friendship really between myself and Una. He didn't know that we'd know. Una's known me since I was a baby. She had her sons round about a bit before, but knew my mother when she was pregnant with me, and so has known me all my life. So there was a sort of something for nothing intimacy that we had through that history, and he just saw how well we got on, on the side of the set, and I think. That was part of what amped up the relationship between Holmes and Mrs. Hudson in the series. Isn't that right? Mm. I'm boring him. He is like Sherlock, I tell you. He really is. It's a very collaborative, wonderful group of actors, so it's very easy to have a push and pull, if you like, to...
With the director and
of course, and a lot's dictated by time and the foresight of his shot, God, what am I trying to say? What is it when you have a storyboarding his shot list when he's done one, and you know weather and all the other things that dictate all the vagaries of filming. So within those constraints, yes, of course we play, we try variations. There's a great scene in Reichenbach where Martin is berating a police officer.
You.
I'm not going to spoil
no,
it.
No,
I'm
no.
very good at not spoiling things. God, get her. I mean, I won't spoil it. But you've all seen it. But yeah, she's berating a. It's all right. This won't ruin it. I promise. Just for this one person, I'm not going to ruin it. And he was improvising a scene, and it was great. And it was lovely to see an actor having complete sort of free range to do that. And every take was different. It was great fun. And you know, we try and vary it as much as we possibly can. And we've known each other for two series now, so we play off each other very easily. And it's great fun. It's great fun.
I have a question for Benedict and Stephen. One of the things that characterizes the Holmes stories is that we know virtually nothing about Sherlock Holmes. And I'm curious if Benedict and Stephen and Mark Gatiss spent any time on the backstory of Sherlock and Mycroft and their antecedents.
No, not really. I mean, it's... I don't think that's how you create a character. I don't think that's how you know a character. I don't think you know a character by creating a backstory for them. Never mind not knowing the backstory for Sherlock Holmes, I'm not absolutely sure that I know the backstory for Mark Gatiss. He's one of my best friends. And if you look at each other, do you really know the backstory? So we sometimes speculate, because we're interested and we chat about it, what his parents were like, what he did. But do you know what? We're not... It's sacred turf. You don't mess that up. You don't bring that into the show. It's not right. There are some things we don't know about Sherlock Holmes, just as there are some things we don't know about our friends, and we don't ever know them. And that's right and proper. I think if we went and did something like that, in a way, the audience wouldn't believe it. They'd say, nah, you just made that bit up, like we didn't make the rest of it up. But, you know, do you know what I mean?
As an actor, it was one of the first questions I asked him, and that's a terrifying response to get, isn't it, if anybody's ever done any acting. You want to hook something of an understanding of how you've grown to be this exceptional, eccentric talent. And for me, it was important. It was important at least to know it. But like he says, all the best backstories are there, but not talked about. Mm. So I have an idea of who he was when he was growing up. I have an idea of how he became what he is as we see him now. We don't necessarily have to show it ever, but it's there, and it does inform the choices I make as an actor playing this character. And I'd say, yeah, I know Mark's backstory. I've got to know. No, I agree with what Stephen says. It's vulgar to need to explain everything, and it would make it so much more boring. But I think it's kind of important to have a little bit of a framework to hang your choices on as an accent.
Hi, the back. I was wondering, do you, after playing Sherlock, do you deduce things about people? Like, are you walking down the street and say, like, oh, that guy's totally, I don't know. You ever do that?
He's stupid. I try not to, because I think it's very dangerous. Was that the end of your question? Sorry.
Oh, no. Also, my friend, who's an amazing artist,
yes.
She may do something.
Oh, thank
and,
you.
And she was a little shy, so, yeah. And it's really awesome.
Oh, great. Well, can you show it from there, or is it too far?
It's very small, but she can probably hold it up.
Oh, wow.
Oh.
Well, that from here looks like a photograph. That's incredible. Mm. Round of applause, I think. That's very good. Thank you very much. But in answer to your question, I was in the middle of an interview today on the phone, and somebody who was dialing a number to extend the interview, it was a journalist to talk about the second series, and she put her hand forward, and I saw there were scratches on it, and I saw the pattern, and I went, have you been traveling with a cat recently? And she had. She had. But the thing is, that's it. That's all it is. You know what I mean? I reach dead ends. The phenomenon about him is he can see the dullest detail and weave the most incredible, sometimes wrong, fabric of story and narrative out of it. And it's one of the joys of watching him do that and being in his company for Watson, I think, that drives the series. But I think, it's very tempting. I think we all kind of get our deducing heads on. I mean, these guys sweat blood and tears, and they are beautiful, beautiful bits of writing. They are phenomenal, phenomenal bits of intellectual imagination. It may be hard to learn them, but it's a darn sight harder to write them.
I think it's worth saying that it's kind of a trick. It's Doyle's trick. He makes it sound really, really credible. But the absolute truth is Sherlock Holmes' main power is never, ever guessing wrong. So he doesn't, you know. But you
have a deduction file, don't you? Which
yeah, when we think of one, we
think of one, you just phone up and say.
Yeah, your brain does. Yeah, you do. We do start
when
to
you see something.
Yeah, when you're doing it, it definitely heightens that perception.
It's interesting because I'm actually not the super fan. I'm definitely a fan, and I think
you know there's 10,000 people.
I gotta say, I love coupling. I love Benedict Cumberbatch. I gotta say, you're fantastic.
You love coupling, you love Benedict Cumberbatch. You've missed my
whole show. Yes, and your cheekbones are beyond words. However, my friend with me is the real super fan. And I could not take credit for this question. However, the question sort of builds on what was already asked, which is, if you woke up and you suddenly had those powers of super deduction and amazing sort of perception of the world, would that change your life and how?
I'd have a permanent headache. If you could look everywhere and see, you know, a multiple of what is singularly in front of you, if everything suddenly starts to expand from one detail into a whole life history, or at least, you know, immediate circumstances of a history, it would be a hard blessing to wear easily. I think it's an extraordinary gift, but it must be quite tiresome. I mean, you know, Sherlock Holmes works at it incredibly hard. I don't think it always just comes to him. He looks for it, and he's trained himself to do that.
Mind you, if you did wake up and discover you'd had that power, be a bloody surprise, wouldn't it?
Yeah.
Telling me. Bloody hell, this is good.
You're telling me.
And your script writing a lot quicker, wouldn't it?
Yes, darling. Bring that up.
What happened when you
stay an
actor?
Crikey.
Yes.
We're really off into metaphorical. Well, yeah, I mean, you know, understanding patterns of behavior and the details of. It's a very sped up version of that. I mean. You'd have to kind of turn it right down to be an actor to get to still moments of calm and try to communicate with an audience other than exploding and talking very fast. But I think, yeah, of course, I think I would. I don't know. I don't know. I don't think I'd like to try it for a day without being an actor. Just run around town and finding out shit about everybody. It'd be great. Oh my God.
Sorry, Facebook. You can edit this one.
Hello. This poor girl.
Google Glasses.
She's waiting.
Can I ask my question, please?
You can.
First of all, I say that we took a bus 10 hours to get here from Raleigh. Wow. Hey. So this has been worth everything in me.
See, that's longer a than super fun.
No, not at all. Can't stand it, you know. My question is for all of you. I've read some of the books, and they allude in the series and Study in Pink how Sherlock, you know, possibly has done drugs and he's, you know, recreationally used cocaine and morphine. I was wondering if season 3, are you guys going to try and explore that or anything? Because, I mean, somebody who uses drugs when they're bored.
Yeah, he doesn't.
I don't think it's the best avenue. One of the interesting things about the original stories is people have become obsessed with the amount of times he takes cocaine. It's not that many. I mean, he smokes more cigarettes. And they never mention that at all. Than he actually does coke.
How many stories is it in,
Jim? Oh, it's only the first few, and I think Doyle realises kids are reading and discreetly buries the whole thing. In the main run of the stories, it's barely mentioned at all.
I think one of the things is someone different now.
Well, that's the thing, isn't it? Mm. Yeah. Someone who takes coke now is probably an advertising executive. And a geek.
Right? One actor.
And you don't want Sherlock Holmes to be that.
That's so. Not a confession. Facebook.
So I don't think it's got the same resonance. When Doyle wrote it for Holmes, it was an exotic thing to do. Yeah. It's not an exotic thing to do now.
No, it's a stupid choice. Yeah. And it's, you know, exactly. He is addicted to his job and his talent. And I think if he's denied that, it's to nullify that sensual lacking, you know, it's to give him something else. And then it becomes very cyclical and addictive. But It's so rarely touched upon in the books. It's such a big deal as made out of it. The fact that it is an Achilles heel in moments of tension where he is incapable of doing his job because he hasn't done it for a while, that's fine. But we have touched on it. We've made more than enough references to it. There's a whole sort of misjudgment on Watson's part in the first episode of the first, wasn't it, of last season?
Yeah.
Where he goes to you, come on, and he goes, shut up. You know, he has a past. He has a past that Watson doesn't know about. So he has done it or something like it. He's dabbled with drugs out of boredom. But, you know, it's about someone who operates at the highest level of his function. And you can't do that if you're inebriated on any level. So, you know, the only reason he does do it is when he's not functioning.
Yeah.
When he's not doing it.
We have time for two more questions.
I have the mic. Okay.
Okay.
Okay. So, I'll just quickly say I love this show so much. We don't have a story about coming 10 miles or something. We're just right here from New York. My best friend here should be studying for her SATs this Saturday, but instead she's here with me because she loves the show too. Okay, so moving on. Question.
Good luck.
Okay, so question. Question mostly for Benedict and Stephen. You guys are obviously known for some amazing shows, and you guys get a lot of love and adoration, and Stephen also some hate from a lot of fans. But
Oh, that's my day, May. Good luck tomorrow.
what I'm trying to say is, because it's such a well-known show series, also Doctor Who, also, and the fans are so outspoken and awesome and not straight-laced often in the slightest. What are some of the weirder fan reactions you've gotten? Do people ever come up and try and quote things to you in the street? Or if you're filming in like a public place, like one of those London intersections, or say Central Park or something like that? Do you get weird fans, and what are they like?
There are many more of you than there are of me. I wouldn't say that, God. No. I've had some weird things, yes. But the best was actually a complete play on what was expected, because there were some weird things happening at one point. And suddenly in the post, I got an Anne Summers whip. Anne Summers, I don't even know. It's a bit like Victoria's Secret. So it was a black whip with a red heart at the end of it. Don't hold your hand up. That means you sent it. She didn't. But I thought it was a fan. It came with a big sort of mystery question mark and kiss. And I showed my friends, guys, this is crazy. I then went on a talk show and was asked the same question. I said, yeah, no, some strange thing. I got a whip in the post the other day. And everyone went,
And obviously, because in that first scene, I'm whipping the cadaver and asking what bruises form in the next 20 minutes. And then I... Was that an applause for that line? I need to come back to this venue. It's great. And then at my friends that I was telling this story to, who then saw me on the show in question, rang me up, and they were crying with laughter. They'd sent it to me. So, yeah, weird and rightfully served.
And have you had any...
I don't think I have anything, not particularly. I was here, we were shooting Doctor Who recently in the new... and my main memory of the fan reaction as I was piling into a minibus with Matt and Karen, and all the fans were clamoring around. It really was, it was lovely, it was fantastic, and they were shouting. I remember this very vividly. It was, Karen, I love you. Matt, marry me. Moffat, could you put your head down a bit?
One lucky person with the last question right here.
Sorry. this is actually a question for Mr. Moffat. Is there any chance we'll have a Doctor Who cameo? And who do you think would have the last word? The Doctor or Sherlock? Or do you think they'd fight to the end of time trying to have the last word?
Me. I'd have the last word. And it would be a stage direction. I don't know. It would be a very, very odd meeting. And I don't think either of them would like it. I sort of always thought, I try to imagine what that's such a meeting. They live in very different universes. I'm not really sure that's ever going to work. I always thought the meeting would be more funny, fun between John Watson and Amy Pond. You know? They could be chatting, just sitting there chatting away. And what's your one like? John would be chatting her up, you'd be getting somewhere, and they'd both stand up. And I thought that'd be fab.
Perfect. So you have been a fabulous, fabulous
you
audience.
Really
Thank
yeah.
you so much for coming. Thank you, PBS.